Well, I don't know when I have been more excited about a series than the one that we're beginning today. I don't know when I've sensed more anticipation from people about a series than the one that we're beginning today. I really believe that the next 6 weeks have the power to give us the spiritual tools that can transform, kind of continually transform our lives for the rest of our lives. And so obviously you're going to want to be a part of these services every weekend between now and Easter, and that's important. But the most important thing that you can do in the next 6 weeks is get into a 40 Days in the Word connection group. Because in those connection groups, we're going to learn each week. We're actually going to have Rick Warren as our teacher in every one of our groups. He's coming via DVD and is going to do like a 20, 25-minute lesson every week on how you can study, interpret, and apply the Bible on your own. Who wouldn't want to have that skill? And so we're going to learn a method in order to do that, where every single one of you don't have to be intimidated by this book anymore. And so you're going to want to get in a group. Here's an unbelievable news. We are launching 70 brand new connection groups that are beginning today and throughout this week, a total of 190 groups. 190 groups. So we got a place for you to connect. In fact, I would like to ask anybody in this room that's hosting one of these 190 groups that we have for 40 Days in the Word, would you just stand for a moment, wherever you are? Would you just stand, some of you in the room? Yeah, let's thank these people, bless these people. Take a good look at them. Take a good look at them. Okay, you can be seated. Now, did you notice? They're just normal, okay? They're just normal. So you can get into a group with some normal people, and also that might say, hey, you know what? There's nothing special about them. I could lead a group. If they can host a group, I could host a group. And if you want to do that, our team will help you do that. Now, here's unbelievable news. I just learned after our last service, we have completely sold out of all of our 40 Days in the Word materials. We have completely sold out of all of our group DVDs. But it's not too late. We're getting more. We'll have them in the office by this Tuesday. So any day this week, from Tuesday on through next weekend, if you want to pick up more materials, if you want to pick up more DVDs, you can do that. Another component I think you'll want to plug into during the next 40 days is take advantage of a 5-minute daily video devotion that you can do just online. And Rick Warren invited myself and 39 other pastors from across the country to do these devotions. I think I'm like day 39 or something. All you have to do is go online to 40DITW, 40daysintheword.com, or you can actually spell it out, Days in the Word, and it will also get you there. You'll see an icon to sign up for the free video devotions every day, and it'll show you how to do that. You just put in your name and email address. If you forget that, just go to the Eastside website, eastside.com, and hit our 40 Days portal, and you can find a route to get there also. So either one of those will work for you. Then the last thing we're doing is we're memorizing Scripture. And we've got these keychains and Bible bookmarks. Joel led us earlier in this week's Scripture from Colossians 3:16. Anybody remember it? I'm going to give you the first word, and let's see how well you can do, okay? Let. That is very impressive. You are so much sharper than the 10 o'clock crowd. I can tell you that right now. I can tell you that right now. So those memory verses are available to you. Now, this weekend today, I want to begin the series, and I want to begin this message by asking you to read a couple of very important verses with me from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. Let's read them out loud together. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. All Scripture is God-breathed. Now, observation. I've noticed that people who are kind of spiritually exploring in their life tend to experience the truth of this verse in reverse order. Now, here's what I mean by that. I watch people who show up at Eastside on weekends and they're spiritually interested. They're not yet followers of Jesus. And they start getting exposed to some teaching from this book. And they say, you know what, that's relevant to my life. and they start to apply it, and they find out that it equips them for every good work, the tail end of this verse. They find the Bible can be applied to their career, to their marriage, to their parenting, to their finances, and it starts to build their confidence in this book a little bit. And then as time goes by, they experience the sharp edge of this book revealing some things about themselves that are painful. They experience this book teaching them and rebuking them and correcting them. And they see things in themselves like attitudes of pride or jealousy or greed or lust or hatred. And it's a bit painful, but they say, you know what? I can't disagree with what it says about me. And so as they experience this book equipping them for every good work, and as it starts to work its way into their hearts, they come to a point where they're about ready to accept, maybe this is a supernatural book. Maybe this actually comes from God. Maybe it is God-breathed. And about the time they're ready to accept this book as a supernatural book, someone says to them, a good friend, hey, you're not falling for this, are you? I mean, you're not going to accept the Bible as inspired, because anybody who has ever seriously read the Bible understands that this is a book with bad history, with bad science, with implausible claims, that it's full of myths and fiction and fables, and you can't trust this book. Friends, today I want to go toe-to-toe with those accusations. Is the Bible full of unreliable history, bad science, implausible claims, fables, and myths, and is it totally irrelevant? Or like this verse says in 2 Timothy 3, is it God-breathed? I want to help you make up your mind on that today by sharing with you evidence for the fact that it is God-breathed. I believe we can trust this book, and I believe you can trust this book, the Bible, first of all, because of its historical accuracy. Historical accuracy. Let me make a statement, and then I want you to think about what's wrong with this statement. Some of the greatest technological breakthroughs of the 1960s occurred when Bill Gates started a company called Apple, whose headquarters is in the Big Apple, New York City. Now, what's wrong with that statement? Okay, let's just back up. No, you're really confused. I've got the wrong date. It wasn't the 1960s. In fact, Apple started in 1978, okay? Started in 1978. Second, I've got the wrong person. It wasn't Bill Gates, who did start Microsoft in Seattle. It wasn't Bill Gates who started Apple. It was Steve Jobs, okay. And it wasn't in New York City. That's not how Apple came about. It happened in Silicon Valley, Cupertino, to be exact. Friends, reliable history gets dates right. It gets people right. It gets places right. So what about the Bible? The Bible makes hundreds of references to historical events and places and peoples and rivers and coinages. And so there's plenty of opportunity for mistakes and inaccuracies in the Bible. But there is remarkable agreement between the biblical account and the historical record. For example, the book of Acts, penned by a physician named Dr. Luke, has uncanny geographic precision when he refers to 32 countries, 54 cities, 9 islands, and historians can't find a single mistake. Dr. William Lane Craig says he's amazed at Luke's grasp of government as he cites the official names of the prelates, magistrates, proconsuls, and governors of his day. Craig said it would have been so easy just to get at least one of those wrong, but Luke gets every single one of them exactly right. The Bible has precisely accurate history, and over the years where there has been a discrepancy between the historical records and the biblical account, further archaeological discoveries have proven the biblical account to be the one that's accurate. For instance, the Old Testament makes frequent reference to a nation called the Hittites. And for years, historians said there's no evidence that the Hittites ever existed, so how can you believe in the Bible as being historically accurate? However, in the 20th century, archaeologists uncovered the capital city of the Hittite nation, and they uncovered 40 cities in the Hittite Empire. For a long time, historians were not sure that a guy named Solomon, King Solomon in the Bible, actually lived. And they were certain that he didn't have the horses that it talks about in the Bible that he had, because they had camels back then. So that can't be right, until archaeologists discovered the city of Megiddo, which I visited last summer with a number of Eastsiders, one of Solomon's chariot cities that has thousands of horse stables in it. In another instance, in Acts chapter 17, Luke refers to Polytarchs as city officials. And for a long time, historians thought that Luke was mistaken, because no evidence of the term Polytarch had been found in any ancient Roman literature. Then archaeologists found a first century arch with an inscription that begins with the words, "In the time of Polytarchs." And since then, archaeologists have found 35 more inscriptions with that term that Luke used. Now, I could cite you case after case after case like that, where what seemed to be an unexplainable contradiction between the historical record and the biblical record was eventually cleared up through further archaeological discoveries pointing to the Bible's accuracy. Now, friends, take any other religion in the world and take its truth source and see if its claims pass the historical accuracy test like the Bible does. The claim that the Bible is full of bad history just doesn't add up. It's not factually responsible to make that claim. This is why, with great confidence, you can say with the psalmist in Psalm 33, verse 4, "The word of the Lord is right and true." It's not only right and true in what it has to say about salvation, it is right and true with what it has to say about history. Now, second, I also trust the Bible because of its scientific accuracy. Now, I want to camp out on this point a little longer than all the others, because there is so much misunderstanding and misinformation about this one. People who think the Bible is scientifically inaccurate just haven't studied the Bible, because God set up the laws of science, and he made sure the world does not contradict the laws of science. Not once does the Bible give bad science. It's always ahead of science. There are things in the Bible that the Bible says were true that we just discovered were true 100 years ago, that we just discovered were true 300 years ago, 500 years ago. Johannes Kepler, the famous mathematician and famous astronomer, said, "Science is simply thinking God's thoughts after him." In other words, he's saying, God established the laws of physics and then we discover them. God established the laws of biology and then we discover them. God established the laws of mathematics and we discover them. God's laws don't ever change, but science is constantly changing. I want you to think about that. Stuff that was thought of as scientific 1,500 years ago was disproven 1,000 years ago. And stuff that thought was scientific 1,000 years ago was disproven 500 years ago. Stuff that we thought was true 25 years ago was disproven 15 years ago. In fact, there is nothing more out of date than an obsolete science textbook. I would almost bet you that the textbook that you had as a third grader in science class is not being used in third grade science classes today, because a lot of the things that are in that book are no longer taught or even believed. How many articles have you read that say that something you thought was good for you several years ago now causes you cancer? Or stuff that they said was fine for a pregnant woman to take 10 years ago, now they say is not fine. Science constantly changes. So one of the proofs that we know the Bible is from God, as he directed it, as he breathed it through human beings to write it, is because of what's not in the Bible. I want you to think about this week, what's not in the Bible. Because if this were a human book, you would expect it to be filled with the inaccurate scientific facts of the prevailing day in which it was written. But it's not there. For instance, for thousands and thousands of years, people believed that the earth was flat, right? It wasn't until Copernicus and Galileo and Columbus that we discovered the earth is round, that it's in a sphere, it's a ball. So you would expect the Bible to say that the earth is flat, because when the Bible was written, that was the prevailing belief of the day, that the earth was flat. But there's not a single verse in the Bible that indicates the earth is flat. In fact, just the opposite is true. It says in 2,600 years ago, the Bible said in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 22, God is enthroned above the sphere of the earth. Some versions say above the circle of the earth. 2,600 years ago, the Bible said the earth is round, the earth is a sphere, the earth is a globe, long before anybody knew it. Now, when that was written, nobody believed that. But God said it, and it was true whether anybody believed it or not. For thousands of years, people believed that this flat earth had to be held up by something. Depending on the culture that you lived in, there were different beliefs about what held up the earth. For instance, if you were Greek, you believed that the world was held up by a giant named Atlas. Yes, Atlas held up the earth. And yet Atlas isn't in the Bible. Why? The Bible even was partially written in Greek, but it's not in the Bible. Why? Because it's not true, so it's not in the Bible. You would expect that somehow someone from that day would have worked that into the Bible if it was a human book. For thousands of years, Hindus believed that the earth sat on the back of giant elephants, and that when we experience earthquakes, it's because the elephants are moving. Evidently, there's more elephants under California than other places. Now, what did the elephant that held up the earth stand on? I'm not making this up. You can read it in any encyclopedia. The elephant stood on the back of a giant sea turtle. And the giant sea turtle stood on the back of a giant sea serpent who swam through a cosmic sea. That was the prevailing attitude for hundreds, if not thousands of years. Yet it's not in the Bible. Even though the Bible was being written during that time. Why? Because the Word of God is right and true. The Bible tells us that Moses was skilled and schooled in all the wisdom of the ancient Egyptians. Because Moses was adopted as the son of Pharaoh's daughter, he went to the best schools in Egypt. He was taught the prevailing science of the day, and the Egyptians were just flat out brilliant. They built the pyramids, they were masters of architecture and engineering and astronomy, but the ancient Egyptians were dead wrong in what held up the earth, because ancient Egyptians believed that this flat earth was held up by five pillars. Now, certainly Moses was schooled in the science of that day because he went to the best school as Pharaoh's grandson. And yet not once in Scripture do you find that the earth is held up by five pillars, even though Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible, of the Old Testament. Why? Because that's not true. So it didn't make it into the Bible. The prevailing science of the day didn't make it into the Bible. In fact, the oldest known written history in the world is likely the book of Job. It's the oldest literature that we know about today. Job was the first book of all the books in the Bible that were written. The books of the Bible weren't written in chronological order. Job is the oldest book. And in Job 26, verse 7, the oldest known literature in the human race, it says, God spreads out the northern skies over empty space. He suspends the earth over nothing. Who told Job? How did he know that? Everybody knows that the earth is flat. Everybody knows that the earth is flat and on the back of five pillars. How did Job know that? Because the Bible only tells what is true and right. Friends, it's just nonsense to say that the Bible is scientifically inaccurate. That means you just don't know the Bible. For instance, take the field of astronomy. Before the invention of the telescope in just the 17th century, Hipparchus said there were 1,022 stars. Ptolemy said, you're wrong, there are 1,056 stars. Kepler came along and said, you're both wrong, there are 1,055 stars. Today, scientists tell us there are at least over 100 billion stars in our galaxy alone, and we don't know how there are many billions of galaxies are out there. And yet thousands of years ago in Jeremiah 33, 22, the Bible said, as countless as the stars in the sky and as measureless as the sand on the seashore. The Bible knew how many stars there were. Today it's widely accepted there are more stars than there are sands on our seashores. I guess Ptolemy, Kepler, and Hipparchus didn't read that in the Bible. The Bible is accurate in the field of medicine. For many years, people believed that too much blood in your body made you sick, and that's what led to the practice that was actually practiced for thousands of years called bloodletting. Doctors would cut a sick person and bleed them, thinking that was going to make them healthy. That was the accepted science. Everybody knew it was true. It was because of Hippocrates. And for 2,000 years since Hippocrates, they believed that all illnesses came from one of four bodily fluids. Those were yellow bile, black bile, red blood, or blue phlegm. And each of those fluids determined also your temperament, your personality. Many people don't know that our first president, George Washington, was killed by doctors bleeding him to death. George Washington had a heart problem. Doctors didn't know what to do, and so they did what was the common science of the day, and they bled George Washington. And when he didn't get well a few days later, they cut him again and bled him a second time. And when he didn't get well, they bled him a third time, and he died for a loss of blood. Now today, we often do just the opposite. We give blood to people when they're sick. We do the exact opposite of what science did for thousands of years. You give people blood because we know that the life source is in the blood. It's called a transfusion. But we didn't know that for thousands of years. But the Bible knew it. In fact, back in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, it says, "For the life of a creature is in the blood." Now, how did Moses know that? We didn't even know that blood circulates through the body until the year 1650. For 2,000 years, people accepted the idea that the heart was actually a source of heat in the body, but didn't know that it pumped blood through your body. Now, friends, I could just keep going with example after example like this. There is no bad science in the Bible. I can trust the Bible because of its historical accuracy, its scientific accuracy, and third, because of its prophetic accuracy. You know, the Bible sets itself up for enormous failure by many of the early writers making bold predictions of things that would happen yet in the coming centuries. Now, if even one of those prophecies was inaccurate, the dependability of the Bible would be in serious jeopardy. And there are over 1,000 separate prophecies. There are over 300 prophecies about Jesus alone that incredibly detailed his lineage, where he would come from, the city where he would be born, the manner of his birth, how he would die, how he would rise from the dead. Some of you say, well, couldn't it be possible that after the life of Jesus, some of his followers who wanted this to be true about him went back and doctored some of the Old Testament manuscripts and inserted some of this information about his life to make it look like it was predicted. Oh, let's say that he'll be born in Bethlehem. Let's talk about him dying on a cross. Let's say that he'll be buried in a rich man's tomb. Well, many people used to buy that theory until the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1947 completely sunk that theory. The Dead Sea Scrolls contained a complete manuscript of the book of Isaiah dating back to 250 years before the time Jesus walked on this planet, and it described in detail his death, his character, his ministry, just as the later manuscripts had. Let me tell you, the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls shook up many scholars in the scholarly community who had previously assumed that these prophecies had just been inserted into later manuscripts. Friends, I think you have to consider fulfilled prophecy as strong evidence for the reliability and trustworthiness of the Bible. Some of you were here a couple years ago when I had my good friend Lee Strobel speak at Eastside. Lee is a graduate of Yale Law School, has a law degree. He was an investigative reporter with the Chicago Tribune for 13 years and was an atheist for most of his life. And then his wife became a Christian. And he was so upset about it that he decided to put his law degree and investigative skills to work to disprove Christianity, and in the course of that became a Christian. And the thing that was most compelling to him that he could not ignore was the amount of fulfilled prophecy in the Bible. He told about a study done by some mathematicians who calculated the odds, the chance, that one human being who lived in history could fulfill just 8 of the prophecies made about Jesus, about the Messiah. Now remember, there are over 300. But they calculated the chance of just 8 of them being fulfilled in one person. And they determined the likelihood of anybody being able to fulfill 8 is 1 chance, not in a million, not in a billion, not in a trillion, but 1 chance in 100 million billion. That's 1 with 17 zeros behind it. Now, I used to live in Vegas, and I can tell you, that's some long odds right there. Now, that's a long shot. Lee used a description one time that I'll never forget. He had a little ceramic tile, about 1.5 inch by 1.5 inch, that he and his wife Leslie had used to redecorate their bathroom in that tile. And he said, let's say that I had enough of these tiles that I could just tile this entire room. He said, the odds of just 8 of these prophecies coming to fulfillment in one person in history, remember there's over 300, but just 8, is like if I could take all these tiles, tile this room, tile everything outside of this room, tile all of Fullerton, tile all of Orange County, tile all of California, tile all of the United States, all of North America, all of South America, all of Europe, all of Asia, all of Africa, all of Antarctica, all of Australia, every city in the world, every place there is landmass in the world, and let's say one of those tiles has a gold star on the bottom that we place down. He said the odds of 8 of those prophecies coming true in one person would be the odds of tiling the entire planet with these little tiles, and you get one shot. You can go wherever. You can go to Beijing, you can go to Moscow, you can go to Rio de Janeiro, you can go to Barstow. The odds of finding the one tile with the gold star. The Bible says in 2 Peter 1:21, for prophecy never had its origin in the human will, but prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. By the way, let me just give you a tip on something. Don't ever trust a psychic who asks for your name and credit card number. I mean, if they're really a psychic, they ought to know your name and credit card number before you tell them, right? In the Old Testament, nobody wanted to be a prophet. Do you know why they didn't want to be a prophet? Because you had to be 100% accurate. And if you were inaccurate just one time, you were considered a false prophet, and the punishment was death. I think you have to put prophetic accuracy as strong evidence for the inspiration of the Bible. So the Bible can be trusted because of historical accuracy, scientific accuracy, prophetic accuracy, and here's a fourth one, thematic accuracy. Is the Bible thematically unified? You say, now why would that be a big deal? Because I've read lots of books, and they're thematically unified from beginning to end. Well, friends, it would be a very big deal for the Bible to be thematically unified, because this book is actually not one book. It is a library of 66 different books written by over 40 different authors over a 1,600-year time frame from 3 different continents and written in 3 different languages. How do you think they all got the same story? It wasn't even collected into one book until after they'd been dead for 1,000 years. And yet the Bible was written by 40 different people in every age and stage of life. And as I said, 3 continents and 3 languages over 1,600 years. And they got the same unified story written by poets and kings and prophets and princes and sailors and soldiers and attorneys and doctors and prisoners and common people. All kinds of people wrote the Bible. It was written in all kinds of locations, written from homes and palaces and caves and on the water in ships from prison cells. And yet it has the same theme through the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation, the same theme, and the theme is redemption through Jesus Christ. You couldn't get a more diverse group of people, fishermen and tax collectors and scholars and business people, and yet they all come up with the same story in one unified whole. Luke 24:27 speaks about Jesus, and it says, and beginning with Moses, Moses wrote the first 5 books of the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, beginning with the books of Moses and all the prophets, that's the rest of the Old Testament, Jesus explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself. Now, did you get that? Most people think the New Testament is about Jesus and the Old Testament is about Israel. Wrong. The New Testament wasn't even written when Jesus was talking about this. He was just talking about the Old Testament. He was saying, the Old Testament, let me tell you what it says concerning me. That it's all about me. And he went through the scriptures and he showed him what it said about him. The story of the Bible is the story of Jesus from beginning to end. The pictures, the metaphors, the analogies, the allusions, everything in scripture from beginning to end is about God working through history to restore sinful people like us into a relationship with him through Jesus Christ. And Jesus is the star, and you see him in every book. It's thematic accuracy. Now, can you handle a couple more? Give them to you quickly. Another reason I trust the Bible is its durability. Throughout history, the Bible has been attacked and banned and burned and criticized, and many have tried to completely wipe it out. The Bible has been the most despised, derided, denied, disputed, dissected, debated, outlawed, the most destroyed and banned book in the history of the world. In fact, today, if you go into North Korea with a Bible, you can be arrested, thrown in jail, and even killed. Same is true in Iran, same is true in a number of different countries. The Bible has been attacked century after century by everything you can imagine, and yet it is still the most read, most published, most translated, best-selling book in the world. It's still making a difference in people's lives. Voltaire, the famous French philosopher, was a brilliant man. He was an atheist, but he was brilliant. And he wrote a number of tracts deriding the Bible. And he made a very famous statement one time in which he said, 100 years from now, you will hear no more about the Bible. Ironically, just 50 years later, and I love this part, the printing press from Voltaire's home was being used to print Bibles. And his homestead was actually being used as a depository for the French Bible Society. Friends, this book is like the Energizer Bunny. It just keeps going and going and going and going. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 24 and 25 says, the grass withers and the flowers fall. I mean, temporary stuff just wilts, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now, one more reason I trust the Bible. I have to admit, it is personally accurate in what it says about me. In fact, I would add this caveat. It is painfully accurate in what it says about me. I've never read a book that cuts through the veneer of my life quicker than this book does. And I'll tell you something about Gene Apple. When Gene Apple compares himself to a lot of people in the world, I can start to feel pretty good about myself. I'm not a terrorist. I'm not a murderer. I love my wife. I love my kids. I pay my taxes. But when I look at what this book says about me, that deep down inside, I'm a person with hate and pride and selfishness and lust and greed, I cannot disagree with what it says about me. Painfully and personally accurate. It tells me I fall short of God's holiness. James 1, 23 and 24 says, anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Man, that takes ADD to a whole nother level right there, doesn't it? Every morning, like you, I get up, I look in the mirror, and I assess the damage of the night before. And you know, I have one of those true mirrors. I don't have like one of those distorted mirrors. I don't have one of those slimming mirrors, you know. Don't you love those? I don't have, you know, anything that, I have like a mirror that gives me an accurate representation of myself. Now, wouldn't it be something to look in the mirror at who I really am, see my hair going every which way and zits on my face and coffee stains in my teeth and all that kind of stuff, and look at the mirror and say, man, I look just like George Clooney today. But when I look in this mirror, I have to agree with its assessment of me and my need for a savior and forgiver and redeemer that this book points to. And friends, here's what else I've learned about this book. This book has transforming power. I've experienced its transforming power in my life. I've seen it transform thousands of lives in my day. I've seen addicts. I've seen alcoholics whose lives change because they start reading this book. I've seen some of the most selfish, abusive, narcissistic men in this world who would take advantage of women, who would take advantage of people financially and get exposed to the truths of this book. And it changes their values and they become godly husbands and loving fathers and models in their community. This book has changed my life and it can change yours. I love this book. This book has led me to a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. This book has comforted me when I've been hurting. It's encouraged me when I've been heartbroken. This book is teaching me how to be a better husband, a better dad. This book is teaching me how to reconcile bruised relationships. This book has given me perspective on my past, wisdom in the present, and it gives me hope for the future. And this book describes the incredible place where I am going to spend forever. I love this book. I couldn't imagine a day of my life without the truths of this book in my life. And my question to you today is, what are you going to do with this book? You can't just dismiss this book as unreliable history, bad science, full of implausible claims and myths and fables and totally irrelevant to your life because the evidence doesn't stack up to that. Now, I know the story of this book is incredible and I know it takes faith to embrace it, but it doesn't take blind faith. It takes faith based on the evidence. So friends, today I ask you, look at the credentials for this God-breathed, God-inspired book. Look at its trustworthiness, historical accuracy, scientific accuracy, prophetic accuracy, thematic accuracy. Look at its durability, how it has stood the test of time, and look at its personal accuracy of what it says about you. And look at the message of it, of a God who loved you so much, he sent his only son into this world because he couldn't bear the thought of spending one day in heaven without you at his side. I challenge you to fully trust this book with your life, with your future, with your relationships, and with your eternity.